What's going on, my beautiful people? We are back. It feels so good to be back. Welcome inside the Black Actors Studio. I'm your host, Danny Royce. Joining me today, he is not only an actor, he's an actor coach, the best here in Hollywood. You've seen him on All American recently. He's a director, entrepreneur. Oh my God, this guy is amazing. Stay tuned. You get to learn all about him.
Tuned into Black Hollywood Live, the world's first digital broadcast network devoted entirely to urban entertainment and pop culture. Tune in right now.
Hey, we back in the studio. Hey, what's up, everybody? Happy Thursday. I'm your boy, Danny Royce. Welcome back. Joining me today in the studio, as I mentioned before, he's not only an actor, but the best acting coach here in Hollywood. This guy is very special to me. He happens to be my coach, also one of my mentors. He has touched the lives of many, many, many actors here in Hollywood, on set, off the set. You've recently seen him in All American. I am very proud, and the Black Actors Studio is very proud to have my friend, my mentor, my coach, Mr. Choice Skinner.
Wow.
What's good? How are you?
That's a lot to live up to, man.
Hey, you do it, so it's fine.
Yeah.
I'm just speaking the truth.
Thank you.
Thank you. It's so Thank great you. To have you in the studio.
I am honored to finally be here. I mean, I've seen this venue many times, many people that I know personally who've been on it.
Yeah.
And, this is special. So, yeah, thank you.
Oh, of course, of course. How are you doing today?
I'm doing amazing, actually.
Yeah. Nice.
Yeah, it's
That's
been a great
up.
Week.
It is. It's, yeah. Hey, it's been a great week. Yeah. It's a beautiful day. Sun's finally out.
Oh, yeah.
It's shining. Oh, it's
yeah.
warm.
Oh, yeah. For those of you who don't know L.A. right now, the weather is amazing.
Yeah.
So, sorry if you're at the snowing or raining or cold, but hey, you know.
But happy holidays. So I just want to say, first off, congratulations on the All-American, one of my favorite TV shows. I saw you dominating on the screen.
Thank you.
How was that, booking that for, role for you?
Well, it's, you know, a lot of people know me mostly as an acting coach and as a director, but it's always weird because I started out as an actor. And I still audition, which, you know, isn't the best thing in the world for me because I'm not an auditioning actor. I firmly believe that some people are, some people aren't. And so for me to go in and to do the role and audition for it was a great opportunity and a great experience. You know, you kind of get that feeling that, you know, when you go in, it's
right.
Like, okay, I think I did really, really good. So I was walking around with that energy of like, yeah, I think I did really, really good. Whether they call me or not, I did it.
Right.
You know, which is always what you have to remember as far as being an actor in the system of auditioning.
Right.
So, the experience was great. Being on set was great. We had a great director who worked that episode. I got to work with Kareem Grimes, who is actually someone studied under me.
Hey.
So here it is 10 years to the time when he first started with training with me. He's on the show as a series recurring / regular, and having the scene opposite with him, I mean, come on, it doesn't get any better.
That's that's dope. That's dope. Well, I want to get a lot into auditioning and then also people you've coached later on. But here in the studio, we always like to start at the beginning.
Okay.
Where were you born?
Brooklyn, New York. Hey. Right down the street from Mike Tyson, actually.
Yeah. So you've seen him a lot growing up, or what?
No, I may have seen him once. We were told to stay away from him and stay away from that area.
Okay.
You know, I had a little run-in with his cousins once, but, you know, that's a story for another time because it's so in-depth. But Brooklyn, New York, growing up in Brooklyn, New York in the 80s, man, you know, there's nothing more special than that. A lot of people came out of that area.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Especially in music.
Oh, yeah. Especially in music.
Yeah,
I grew up
yeah.
right across the street from Jefferson High School, and the Fat Boys was from that area.
Uh-huh.
So they used to be right there in Jefferson High School going to school, and
That's
I would
crazy.
See Buffy, you know, going back and forth. So I was like, man, you know.
That's dope. That's dope. What about your father and your household? Was it how was the dynamics in your household, I should say, growing up?
Well, in the 80s, you know, that was the onslaught of the single mom syndrome.
Yeah.
You know, the black community was hit hard with crack and alcoholism and stuff like that. And living in the projects, it was a thing of, you know, you had a lot of strong mothers. I am blessed to have one of the strongest moms. And everybody loves their mom, but my mom, she raised five boys. Mm. So I have four brothers. And, you know,
that's
she...
That's a lot.
Oh, man. That's a lot. I am who I am primarily because of God, but also because of my mom. Mm-hmm. Because my mom, at a certain age, went back to school and got her GED and then went to college and got even credits from Harvard. So she graduated with a bachelor's degree. Mm-hmm. And so when you see something like that, okay, on one hand, you have the streets, right, which calls to you, you know. I always knew that there was a better plan for me. And so she incorporated me into martial arts. Shout out to my martial art instructor, Dyron Jackson. And I had great teachers. So in the house, yeah, it may have been a little tumultuous, mm-hmm. you know what I mean? Like you got literally four young boys, other than myself, who she's raising, and then finding a way to make sure we're provided for. So we always ate. I mean, I don't celebrate Christmas anymore, but we had the best Christmases. Mm. My mom made sure that the house was what it needed to be and we were well provided for. If I didn't eat, it was by choice, not because it was not
And you learn to eat what's on your plate, right?
Oh, yeah.
For sure.
But I was picky. You know, my name, Choice, is really my name.
Picky is I don't know what. Oh, my God.
I mean, I'm not a vegan or a vegetarian, but I'm picky, though. You know what I mean?
Right.
You know.
They say we're bad. Vegans are bad.
Yeah.
So do you have any nicknames growing up?
Yeah, my uncles and my aunties, they would call me Choicey. Mm. When I was really, really young, one that I used to hate was Turtle. I don't know where, I would get that in elementary school. Hey, you look like a turtle. It's like, okay, I guess I got to accept that.
Oh, wow.
But for a long time, I went by my middle name, James, you know, which is my dad's name. You know, my name's Choice James Harrell Skinner. So his name is James Harrell. He died 2 months before I was born. So I never had a dad. I don't know what that is.
Mm-hmm.
But I went by James because I didn't like the attention of Choice.
Right.
I didn't like it until I came out to Hollywood and I started auditioning. And the casting director, she said, "What's this Choice here? What is that?" And I said, "That's my real name." I said, "My middle name is James." She said, "Well, why don't you use your first name?"
Yeah.
And I started using my name then. But before that, I wouldn't, because people would make up those, you know, the Choices on Channel 5. I mean, just everything.
Just everything.
Like, oh, yeah, Chancy. You know, I was like, yeah, I'm good. Just call me James.
James. Yeah. Keep it wild. Mm-hmm. Nice, simple. So did you get along with your other brothers?
Well, yeah. I mean.
Was your guys a tight-knit group or not?
Yeah,
really?
I mean, I would say we're closer now.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there was always some contention. You know, when you're in a project, you have five boys growing up in a, you know, three-bedroom apartment. There's always going to be that alpha male thing going on. You know, my older brother, he was nuts, but he kept us safe. You know, and I do have to give that to Kurt. Mm-hmm. You know, he kept us safe, and he made sure that people didn't mess with us.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? People like Mike Tyson and them. They didn't mess with us. But, you know, it was always that vying for finding yourself. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, I do a lot of work for, you know, underprivileged young males and guys who have been through stuff like hard times like that. So for me, I have this understanding of, okay, yeah, I know what that's about, especially if your dad's not around.
Right.
You know, you're vying for attention, you're vying for space, you're looking to figure out how to become a man. A woman can raise, you know, young men, but she can't make a man.
Yeah.
So you have to, you know, but I was fortunate. Like I said, I had Dyron Jackson, I had my martial art instructor, I had, you know, I started working at 10. So I worked, you know, at the little bodegas and stuff.
Okay.
You know, so I had Dominican, you know, mentors, Puerto Rican mentors, black mentors, old man Al, who taught me, you know, the understanding of who I am as a young black man in America.
Right.
Different things that helped me. And, you know, some of my uncles and my aunties.
Was for you, with the absence of your father, did you, like, actively seek these things from other men in your life, or is it just kind of something that happened?
No, I actually ran from any type of testosterone and anything dealing with that alpha type of thing, because, you know, I was molested at 2 and 6.
Mm.
So I carried that for a long time. And then growing up in the neighborhood, there was a lot of tension. You know, young black men have a lot of tension, and there's always fighting, and there's always this we used to call it rah-rah.
Yeah.
And so I would stay, you know, I didn't really get into sports. But once I got to martial arts, I got into more of that physical stuff, lifting weights and fighting, boxing, stuff right. like that. Anything that I could use to protect myself. So there wasn't a lot of that that I would search for. I was always the bookworm. I wanted to know things.
Gotcha.
You know?
Hey.
And so my godbrother would fight my battles. Nathaniel Smart, he was the one that everybody, you know, respected him. You know,
okay.
he fought some of the up-and-coming boxers and took care of them. So I lived vicariously through him as far as when it came to the fighting, because I was more of a peacemaker.
Mm.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, for sure.
And so, yeah, the tension was the thing that kept me away. A lot of that animosity and that anger that, you know, we go through as young black men, I stayed away from that mm-hmm. as much as I could. I wouldn't be on the basketball court, so, you know, I stayed away from it.
Yeah.
So, suffice to say, I can't play basketball to save my life or yours, you know?
Right. The one black person in America who can't play basketball, choice knows shit.
Hey,
I'm just kidding.
I turn those roles down, man. I don't go in for them. I'm serious.
When did you get that feeling that, you know, I really enjoy performing? I really enjoy. And I know you were in the music industry
yeah.
for about 20 years.
Yeah. yeah.
So tell me about that and then the transitioning to, like, acting.
Well, when I was young, you know, for a form of escapism, and I think that's what Hollywood needs to remember to get back to, you know, films are not just about political agendas, but escapism,
mm-hmm.
because a lot of us were saved by films.
Yeah.
You know, movies in the 80s and the 70s, those things affected us. So I was always writing short films and, recording TV shows mm-hmm. remaking them and recording them on tapes and, and little recorders and stuff. I, at the age of, six, I knew I wanted to be in the entertainment industry. My first play was playing Eric the Red. So you talk about diversity.
Wow.
I got to play a Viking
hey.
At 6 years old.
And, inclusion, what?
Inclusion, no. yeah, you know what I'm saying? And diversity, you know.
Right.
So I got to play that, and I knew I was hooked. But I kind of leaned more towards music before I got into the film and stuff. And music
okay.
was a form of escape. You know, my mom said at the age of 2, I was able to go to the record player and flip over to the right side of the record.
Mm.
You know, so that tells you a little how old I am. I don't even think people know what vinyl is anymore.
Right.
Or record player. But I was able to do that. And with that being said, I developed perfect pitch. And so once I got into production and songwriting, I was able to take that, and one of my boys, William Anthony, but his name, he goes by Shadidi now, but he was the one that instituted funk and teaching me about, you know, theory of music, because he made me listen to some people who I wasn't used to.
Mm.
So from music, then I ventured into understanding the art form. Like, I never forgot what it was to perform.
Right.
You know, I put on a ghetto version of Romeo and Juliet. It was insane. People actually showed up.
Hey.
You know, but I had got this girl in my building when I was a kid, and we got together, and I made some cookies, and I put notes up and signs and told everybody we're going to do Romeo and Juliet.
Wow.
Got a little cape. And we did. I don't even remember what we did, but we did something, and people were there clapping.
Wow.
So I guess that's when, that narcissism kicked in. I'm like, I want people to watch me.
You know? That's dope, because you hear a lot of people, like, you know, when they're younger, they're inspired by certain things, but you were actually, like, going through with it and, like, actually producing as a little yeah. producer and director, you know.
Yeah.
That was pretty dope. And then the home videos, yeah, I used to do that in my house too. Just great films. What shows are did you watch growing up that really impacted you?
Well, everybody knows how old I am, so I'm telling pretty much. I'm going to go all out. Dynasty was number one. Dynasty was the show. It was all drama. It was all drama. Mork and Mindy, Laverne and Shirley, Happy Days, Good Times.
Okay.
TV shows like that. I mean, it was different then, because, like I said, it wasn't so much just about the political agendas. They're there sometimes,
mm-hmm.
right? Okay.
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes you have these amazing actors who come in and take things to another level. So when I'm watching these shows, I think it's not just that I'm being entertained, but I'm saying, man, that person is interesting.
Yeah.
And I've learned, even as an actor, like, we're not interesting until people see our lives outside of ourselves,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yeah.
And so when we look at a TV show, we say, well, that person is extra, but somewhere that person exists.
Mm-hmm. Very true.
That's the characterization.
Yeah.
So TV shows for me was anything like Cosby Show, anything that was, first of all, anything that showed black people.
Right.
You know, I mean, I know I mentioned a lot of shows that didn't have black people in it, but if the show had black people in it, A Different World, something like that, mm-hmm. I was watching it. Yeah. Didn't matter. I was watching it. Mm-hmm. Superhero shows, I was watching it.
Yeah.
The First Flash, I watched stuff like that.
Uh-huh.
People don't remember this, but there was a show called Manta.
Oh, okay. I don't think I remember that either.
Oh, man. And it was one of the first black superheroes on television. And he was an original creation. He wasn't from Marvel or DC.
Uh-huh.
They created it for the TV show. And actually, that actor ended up being in Supergirl as the father of Martian Man.
Wow.
Yeah. So
got to figure out that actor's name.
Oh, yeah, we got to figure it out because, it was like, oh, he's on Supergirl. You know, a lot of those actors from that era, they put them on these shows now.
Yeah,
and
for
so,
sure.
Yeah, Lindsay Wagner and all of them, you know.
What about, what were some black figures growing up and getting into the acting that really inspired you to say, okay, you know, I can do this?
Well, I didn't really get like that until I was, I would say, in class. Like when I got into acting class, because I never really thought that I could act.
Okay.
You know, I had an idea of what I thought acting was, which was more of a play mindset.
Right.
You know, because there is a difference between a play actor and a television actor or a film actor. There are differences. They're all great mediums, and to me, they're all equal. You get people say, oh, you know, theater is better than film actor. No, a theater actor goes through the whole show whether they mess up or not.
Right.
In television or film, you mess up, you got to stop and start and go again.
Exactly.
And you may have to do it 40 times. That takes endurance. So to me, I get upset when I hear actors say, oh, this is better than that. No, they're all forms and mediums that we all need to learn and respect. You know, when people say, oh, well, you know, I've done Shakespeare. Well, I've done Shakespeare too.
Yeah.
And so I don't allow that to be something where people say, you know, oh, that's better than better. But to answer your question, once I got into acting, then, yeah, it was Denzel, Howard Rollins, who people hardly know too much about. And, you know, he was back in the 80s. He was one. He would be where Denzel is at now had he lived.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, we lost him at an early age. And, you know, Andre Brower, mm-hmm. Lawrence Fishburne, even Cuba. You know, Cuba, when I got into acting, I would, in acting class, play all the lead actors. Didn't matter who it was, Wesley Snipes. If I could get the material, I brought it into class, and those were the people who inspired me. Yes, of course, you know, Anthony Hopkins was one of my favorite.
Right.
I met him. It changed my life, you know. Mm-hmm. But as far as a black male actor, I knew I had to work on material that I was going to be going out for.
For sure.
Yeah.
So what's one of the best memories you have when you met Anthony Hopkins?
It was a night. I was... you know, I was guiding parking for my acting coach. You know, she would let me work the parking lot. And so I was guiding parking, and this guy shows up in a white Mercedes SUV, and he hops out. I'm like, oh, my God, it's Anthony Hopkins. I look upstairs to see if anybody else notices what I'm noticing. It's just a woman. It's just him and I. And he goes, hi, I'm Tony. And I'm like, I know who you are. And he says, and you are? And I'm like, I'm Choice. He's like, that's a brilliant name. And I said, that's my real name.
Nice.
I said, no pretension here. So he says, well, he shakes my hand, and then he hugs me.
Wow.
And I said, this is what it's about. You know what I mean? Like, because I don't really fanboy out. Like, there are people who I want to meet. I'm still waiting to meet you, Janet. It's going to happen. I've met Prince. I've met some cool people who I've wanted to meet
Prince,
in my life.
Man.
Yeah, you know?
Crazy.
But it wasn't a fanboy moment, and it was like, this is it. Like, you know, Anthony Hopkins, one of my favorite actors of all time.
Right.
And so it was a moment. Like, I look at them, they're all moments. And you have to remember and remind yourself that these moments, if you receive them, you're blessed.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's not going to happen for everybody.
But right.
If it happens for you, it's part of that greatness recognizes greatness.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And so I let him know, and he let me know, and that was that.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
And when you started studying... What was one of the biggest challenges you found getting into? Because, you know, headshots, there's classes, there's auditioning, like we all know the cost, the expenses. But you know, you got to have that passion, that will to drive. So, what was something that you found the most challenging?
You ask good questions.
Thank you.
At the time when I was studying, I always tell people this: like, I was eating donuts, water, and eggs, you know what I mean, to survive. I would book something, and I'd put that money aside for class. I'd, you know, give my mom some money, I'd pay bills, and then I'd just put money aside for class, and I'd prepay for class. I'd make sure that class was everything. As far as the challenge is concerned, I grew fast. And so the challenge for me was, first off, I had to overcome that I didn't look like, you know, the hottest next Denzel. I didn't look like a lot of these, you know, Morris Chestnut guys, stuff like that. I had to overcome that. That was a personal thing. Because we're all attributed specific gifts and certain things that we're capable of doing. So I had to be honest with myself and say, you know, how do you see yourself as an actor? I think that was the hardest part. Because, like I said, I worked on all these people's material, but I still didn't know who I was. And then that's when I started realizing, oh, well, acting is finding yourself. It's knowing who you are and being cool with who you are and what you don't have. Because a lot of times people get in and it's like, how many people would change their body if they had the money to do it? That's very toxic. That's dangerous.
It is.
You see? So accepting yourself, you know, good or bad, relative term, you know, accepting yourself, whatever it is you don't like about yourself or you do like about yourself, is part of the battle. So challenges for me, that there weren't really too many. I can say that when I first got in, it was hard for me to let loose and cry, to be vulnerable. And that was because, you know, I always say the people who have a lot to cry about are the ones who won't cry. Right?
Very true.
And so when it happened, it never went back.
Right.
And I knew that.
The floodgates were open.
but photos and stuff, I'm the type, and my manager will tell you, if she asked for it, unless I forget, it's done.
Yeah.
And so I never understand when actors have a hard time with their managers or agents. Their agents or their managers say, hey, I need this, and they don't do it, or they take advantage of it. It's one of the fears. Fear of success or fear of failure.
Yeah.
That's all it is. And for so sure. There was never a challenge for me, because I'm an extremist anyway, 0 to 100. So it's like, you know, what does it matter?
Right.
You know, let's just get it done.
Right.
Yeah.
So you mentioned vulnerability, and I find that a big topic in the Black community, especially men. What's something that you would tell someone to, you know, kind of as a step to get towards that vulnerability, that vulnerable spot?
Well, that's changing. I mean, you got, you know, Kanye era.
True.
You know, from my era, it was tough because, you know, listen, I think the dynamic is, and this is just speaking about Black men in general for a second, we don't know who we are, and we're always looking to find ourselves, and we're always dealing with how people are telling us who we should be, how we should be, you know, with this toxic masculinity thing. We got all these different things,
right. And
we can never make anybody happy. So what I do with actors is I say, know yourself. Like, I've been through a lot, and so I always tell my actors, like, I got an actor named Jason Woods who can do 20, the last time he was on television, he had to do 20 takes on a previous show, and he did 20 takes of crying, and what he remembered was I said that you have a never-ending pool of tears. As long as you have tear ducts and as long as you have a heart, you can fall apart. Mm-hmm. You can do it. You don't need a tear stick or, you know, a crying stick or all these things that people are using. And I mean, we specialize in making sure that you're able to find your triggers or to feel, you see? And for me, it's a thing of the empath versus the doer. You have some people who are doers, and they're looking for a technique to figure out how to do it. And then you have empaths who, you blow on them, they feel everything, right?
Right.
They fall apart. Oh, my God. You know, they watch a movie, they fall apart. They look at a dog, they're sad, they fall apart.
Mm-hmm.
And figuring out which one you are, sometimes you could be an empath who was trained to be a doer. Sometimes you could be a doer who was trained to be an empath. It's all about finding your strength and finding your triggers. I don't believe in 7 steps or 14 steps or 15 steps. It's just ridiculous. Or a substitution. I don't believe in that. I believe that, you know, if you use a past experience, it's kind of like a scab. When you peel it off, after a while, it heals harder. It doesn't hurt anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you're using that as a trigger, it's not going to feel the same every time.
Right.
But love. Now, if you love and the person that you love is gone, every time you think of them, you'll fall apart.
Right.
If you allow yourself to feel, you'll fall apart. It's not hard. You just have to chip away at the veneer and the steel dome you've put yourself in to protect yourself.
Right. That's so true. And then breaking through an acting workshop. Mm-hmm. All right. Happy 10-year anniversary.
Thank you.
Exactly.
Thank you.
Tell us what made you want to go on this venture to helping actors and touching lives and just changing the game.
I gave it a lot of thought. Shout out to Daphne McGarry Clark. She was the one that planted the seed in me to have the strength to do it. Mm-hmm. I know that it's a responsibility. And I give a lot of myself. I mean, I coach on a Monday or Friday. It takes me days to recover. My actors, they're no joke. They come in ready. A lot of people come in, they see the class, they're not ready for that.
Right.
And they're used to steps. You know, there's no place to hide in breaking through. When I started, I knew that there were things that actors needed. They needed to learn discipline first off, which is why a lot of theater actors are great in what they do, because, you know, they deal with the material and they have to know the lines. They have to know how to hit their mark. They have to do it over and over and over and over again, prepare for the show.
Right.
And so that was important to me, that my actors would be disciplined. My actors would be accessible emotionally. Mm-hmm. My actors wouldn't take the time to be thinking when that's the job for the director, the writer, and the producer. Mm-hmm. Show up and be prepared for whatever it is, any adjustments for auditioning. So there were things that I knew that I said, okay, I got to make sure that this, if I'm going to give people what they need, I'm going to train them to be better than me. Mm-hmm. Because I ain't no joke. You know what I'm saying? So that's the purest form of love, right?
Right.
Your parents gave, if your parent loved you, they gave you what they didn't have.
Mm. Yeah.
You see?
Yeah.
And in this town, I always say actors are like cows. They migrate together in different places. Mm-hmm. It's like moo, moo, moo. You know, and who's the next hottest coach, or what's the next hottest technique?
Right.
Or what's the next hottest book, or this or that, and the next course. And it shouldn't be about that. If you're really investing in yourself, then you should be thinking about yourself in regards to how do you grow.
Right.
Because the more you know yourself, the more you know human behavior. The more you know human behavior, the better you'll be able to act. Mm. Because now you're understanding, you know, the character's motivation, the character's desire, wants,
right,
needs, all that stuff that everybody in every class talks about.
For sure.
You see?
Hey, yeah.
So when I started it, I said, okay, what do I want it to be? I want it to be a community, a safe haven for actors to really, really explode and grow. Just, and that's how it is in theater. Theater in New York is like that. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm from New York, so the people who I hang around, they're all theatrical and theater-based actors. Mm-hmm. They don't play. They're
right.
Serious about it. They got their Shakespeare under their belt. They make sure they know their lines. They show up. They're prepared. They're diligent. You know, they're something that Samuel Jackson has said one time. He said, you know, this kid asked him, he said, what's your best idea of what it is to make it? He said, go do some theater.
Mm-hmm.
He said, because in LA, everybody's for themselves, but in theater, it's us. It's a collective.
Yeah.
It's a community.
So true.
And so that was the objective. Create a community where there's no pressure. We have a no pressure policy. You don't have to do something if you don't want to do it. Guess what? You don't even have to be here.
Mm-hmm.
Don't come here if you don't want to work.
Right.
You see? And if you're not going to show up and do what you need to do, don't do it, because you wouldn't do that on set. So we're preparing you for set now.
Right.
That's breaking through in a nutshell.
Hey, yeah. I love being a part of it.
And you're great.
Yeah.
You're great. Thank you. I mean, you know your lines. You show up. You're ready. The camera loves you. You enjoy what you're doing. Mm-hmm. To me, I think that's where we suffer as a community of actors. You know, it doesn't matter. Black, white, doesn't matter. I think if what we're missing was that you trained and you studied hard for anything. Like, everyone says, oh, I want to be a character actor. It's like, no, be an A-list actor. Mm-hmm. Because A-list work when they want to work.
Right.
Working actors don't always work.
Yeah.
Character actors limits you, you see?
Mm-hmm.
So you can be like Brad Pitt. Brad Pitt started out, he was the guy with the 8-pack, you know, for a long time. And then he became an A-list actor. And so now, at his older age, he's able to play these characters.
Mm-hmm.
These off-the-wall, zany characters.
Right.
So be an A-list actor who can do character work.
There you go. That's true. And I just want to say thanks again for being in the studio today.
Also,
thank you everybody who's watching right now, those are tuning in. If you like what you see, go ahead and click thumbs up and make sure you subscribe, Black Hollywood Live. Thank you to Kevin Undergaro and Maria Menounos for allowing me to come here every week and just bring these amazing guests to y'all. And also, if you want to check out season one, full season one, 20 episodes, you can find it at www.theonchannel.com. So that's onchannel.com. You can check out the whole season one, 20 episodes. Here we are, season two.
That's a mouthful.
We're going in, I know, right? Taking a breath. Hold on. Okay, I'm good. Thank you so much. It means a lot being here. I'm truly blessed to have this platform and just to be bringing these people into your lives, into your cars, wherever you listening or watching this. So I want to go back to auditioning. You strongly believe that they're, you know, not non-auditioning actors, and they're auditioning actors. So can you just elaborate a little bit on that and what your opinions are on these audition technique classes?
Yeah, listen, and I know it's controversial because I've had people tell me, oh my God, how could you say that? Well, it's because it cuts back on people's money. Right. You know, if they tell you, hey, we got this course, it's $500, it's just 2 days, we can prepare you to get ready for auditions, you'll get rid of it. The only way anyone can ever be fully comfortable in their position, in their environment, and in their skin is if they are not nervous.
Yeah.
And I can thank my acting coach, Bobby Chance, for giving that to me because she would always say that. And I said, how does a person get to a place of not being nervous? Mm. And that's just being comfortable in who you are.
Yeah.
You know, you have to understand why you're doing it. If you don't know why you're doing it, then there's going to be pressure. And pressure will always bring in a level of nervousness. It doesn't matter who you are, you see. So it still it intrigues me to hear actors and musicians say, oh, I'm so nervous. I'm like, ooh. You know, nervous about what? Because there's a lot of things in life, you know, I'm not going to get into detail, that we do where we're not nervous.
Right. Yeah.
We're not nervous.
Right.
And so if that's the case, then how do you work towards that? Well, if you know who you are, if you know you're the type of person where you're looking to be a perfectionist, you're looking to get it right all the time, that's pressure. Maybe that's how you were raised. Maybe you were raised to be that person where you had to get it right. Mm-hmm. Maybe you're very competitive, and there's nothing wrong with that. You know, I think now the industry has become much more competitive than it used to be.
Yeah.
And so you have to have a sense of competition in your mindset. You know, with the advent of social media, Facebook, Instagram, you know, everybody wants to have their opinion. Everybody wants to be number one. I get it. But what happens is when you know if you're an auditioning actor or not, you know yourself.
Mm-hmm.
So I know me. I know that, okay, some days I can go in if the role is great, if the room is nice. I've been in rooms where it's just like, oh, I can't breathe. I've been,
right.
You see what I'm saying? I've been in some, and that's not because I'm nervous. It's just because it just didn't feel right.
Right.
You know, the feng shui of the room is not right. But then I've been in rooms where I didn't get the role, but I had the best. I just had an audition a month ago, and it was amazing. It was, it was the best feeling. It was a moment. It was great. I had to hug the casting director and I thanked her. But I know I'm not an auditioning actor. Even though I've booked and I've done stuff, I'm not an auditioning actor because I don't like the experience.
Mm.
And we are the only ones in the world as artists, as entertainers, that have to do things that they don't like.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you're not a star yet. You got to work at that restaurant. You got to, you know, bartend. You got to do those jobs in order to keep going.
Mm-hmm.
You see?
Yeah.
Musicians can get paid as amateurs.
Yeah.
Little bands, little gigs, they get paid as amateurs and get better as they play. We're the only ones that, you know, we go in, we don't get paid for our time. We go into an audition. You ride on that 405 or that 101.
Or, yeah,
you know what I'm saying? Yeah. And you ride all the way there. You're sitting in the lobby. They may have already casted the role. You don't know.
Yeah, very true.
Sometimes they come out. They give you sides for another role. They say that one's cast or we're not looking for that one. We're looking for this. Or you didn't get the sides and they were like, we sent the sides out, but you didn't get them.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to learn on the spot. Can you imagine where that process takes a person?
Yeah.
Imagine getting to a point where you have roles and stuff sent to you. Something happened in your life and you come all the way back down where you have to audition again. So we are the only ones that have to go through that. Even musicians. Musicians will never have to go and audition to get a job.
Right.
You know, if they took time off, Alanis Morissette just started touring again.
Ah, I love Alanis.
She's Alanis Morissette.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? You know, she didn't have to go and audition to get the part. Well, right. I gotta show you where my voice is at now. You know, right. A lot of these people who are musicians, they play in these carnivals and these, you know.
Yeah,
these,
festivals all that, yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And they're 50, 60 years old. Some of them don't have a voice. Drug use and stuff tore their voice up.
Right.
Actors are the only ones that have to go in for somebody to say yes or no.
Yeah. Very
true. Only ones on the planet.
You know, if I'm an outsider looking in, you know, I would think you're crazy as hell to pursue this. You know, and you got to be a certain type of person to pursue this in industry. What would you tell someone that's like, you know, after hearing that, I wanted to be an actor, but I don't know anymore.
You got to know what you want.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of people are told this is what you should do. You know, it's kind of like I feel bad for the pageant girls, you know, because they're getting in because it's fun, but then it becomes this thing.
Yeah.
And so they live vicariously through these little girls, and it's just toxic. And actors don't know that, okay, here it is. I moved all the way to L.A. I want to do this. No one tells you that, you know, you're not going to be able to eat that day, or you may be sleeping in your car, or you're going to meet people who are going to do you dirty, and people who are going to want to take advantage of you, and, you know, acting studios or classes where people want to take your money, or they want to give you bad knowledge or bad insight, but, you know, they just want to find a way to use you. Mm-hmm. No one tells people that. I mean, there's an idea of it, but we all have that. You know, I would say there's three things happening. You're living the dream. No, you're dreaming the dream, you're chasing the dream, or you're living the dream.
Mm.
Mm-hmm. Very few people. Everybody can dream the dream. Everybody dreams the dream. Some people chase it.
Yeah.
Very few people live it. And that's the people who go off and become, you know, someone like my student, you know, Bree Winslow, who I was just on set watching her. And it's like looking at what she's accomplished in just a turn. She made a choice. She made a move and went through months. She booked some stuff, little small things. She, you know, but... And it wasn't until towards the end of the year that she booked that thing that changed her life.
Yeah.
It's a series regular now.
Yeah.
You know, or Amber McWilliams, who, you know, she came out, she saw what this thing was all about, and she worked really hard and said, I'm not going to wait. I'm going to do what I want to do. And she created her own short and hired me as a director and hired people from the class. Those people, to answer your question, those people see the adversity and the obstacles, and they say, no, it's not about my circumstances. Mm-hmm. They don't define me. I define my circumstances.
Mm-hmm.
That's the strength, because everybody gets those bumps and bruises. It's the person that keeps going up the mountain that will not stop in spite of everyone coming down saying, man, you don't want to go there.
Hey, I don't go that way.
Yeah, right. See?
It's like, come on.
Yeah. So for me, it's a thing of understanding self.
Yeah.
Because that, in the end, you have to know the person you want to be.
Right. And you're very creative, director, producer.
Mm. Who told you that?
I mean, I've seen it. No. Very good behind the camera, all that. And you have a great project in the works, Henry's Courage.
Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about Henry's Courage.
Yeah. Henry's Courage is a short film that I had been wanting for a while. You know, I found out about this like 3 to 4 years ago. I didn't know that there was... Henry Johnson, a soldier who was part of the 369th Regiment during World War I in 1918, who fought over in France against the Germans. And him and Needham Roberts were in a ditch. They were in like a, what's called, we would look at it as a ditch, but they pretty much, I can't even think of the name of it now all of a sudden. But
where they would go like...
like a foxhole, but...
Yeah, a burrow?
Something like that. But they fought, and they kept the Germans at bay, and he sustained 21 injuries, and he fought off over 24 Germans, him and Needham. And I felt so inspired by it, because as a black man, you know, in America... We don't really have that many heroes. We have heroes, but the stories are not there. And I was so taken aback that I'm finding out about a trench. That's what it was.
Trench. There you go. I knew we get it. You got it.
I was so like how come I didn't know about this?
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Like the dolls that I play with, G.I. Joe, a real American hero. That tagline was Henry Johnson.
Yeah.
That's where it came from.
Yeah.
And he just got a Medal of Honor from Obama when Obama was in office. So, of course, postmortem, you know, honor. And I said, you know what? We need to hear this story. And I believe that the best way to teach anyone or to reach anyone is through media.
Yes.
You know, because that is what shapes and forms our minds. It's a form of programming.
Right.
So when people say, oh, it's just a movie, I'm like, no, it's not.
It's not.
It's not.
It affects people's lives.
Yeah.
So much.
Yeah. And a lot of people don't read. And I understand right. that. You know what I mean? I mean, I've gotten to a point where I'm reading scripts and stuff all the time. I got people say, read this book. I'm like, when? It's
right.
not going to happen.
Right.
So I wanted to make this short. You know, there's no way I could make a feature because it would take the finances to make it. But, you know, for $70,000, I'm going to shoot this short with a bunch of my actors and people who know what they're doing,
mm-hmm.
who are coming on board. We have like top-notch VFX specialists, and we have Art Collins, who is a historian. He was the historian for Miracle of St. Anna.
Mm-hmm.
He's been helping us with the script, making sure things are right, because right. I'm a firm believer of the story can tell itself. You don't have to, you know, fudge it so much to where it doesn't even make sense.
Right.
So I'm going to tell this story, and more than likely we'll be shooting in April. We're doing a Kickstarter right now. So
yes.
go to Kickstarter.
Tell everyone where to find it.
Yes, yes, yes. Go to Kickstarter, and Henry's Courage is the / Henry's Courage is our page. We're down to 10 days, so we need as much help as possible. If anything you can donate, it's going to be tremendous for us.
Yes, let's get this movie made. Mm-hmm. That's a mm-hmm. great story that needs to be told. Also, another great story that needed to be told, Harriet. So, right, we're not even going to go too deep into it, but I understand your point of view on certain things, and I want to just, you know, talk a little bit about that as far as the influx of Brit actors coming into the U.S., particularly black mm-hmm. Brit actors. And so what's your stance on that and the roles that are being handed to them?
Well, first off, with Harriet, you know, listen, I get it, you know, as a black female director, as a black female lead actor, as a black female producer. Yeah, I get it. Like, you know, females in the industry, specifically black females, have been downtrodden for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
That shouldn't excuse the things that are done. Okay, so it's when you look at a film like Harriet, you know, you're talking about an American hero. She's the female American hero. Here it is, I'm doing a black male American hero. She's a female American hero, mm-hmm. not just to black people, but also to white people and other cultures. And,
right.
you know, here's a woman who took people out of slavery. And you're making a film, and then you're adding a lot of inaccuracies or falsehoods to push the narrative. It's not helping anybody, because we go back to what we said. A lot of people don't read.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, okay, people start to believe that
yeah.
that's what it is. That's the danger in that.
Yeah.
In regards to it being who it was starring, I'm not going to name call, but, you know, you don't disrespect the people that you're saying you're coming to entertain and to serve.
Hmm.
I wouldn't do that. You yeah. know what I mean? I don't know anything about Britain. Other than what I've seen in films and what I've read in history. I wouldn't dare presume to think that I can go over there, play a British person or an icon. Listen,
yeah.
okay, China shut down Quentin Tarantino mm-hmm. with Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. And there was a reason why. You don't mess with Bruce Lee.
Mm-hmm.
That is a national hero.
Right.
So if China can have that way about it, how come we can't? Why is it that the black culture must accept everything done to them?
Mm.
Why is it that we can't stand up and say we deserve to be treated and respected when it comes to our cultural icons and also in film? So, you know, when you look at the British actors, okay, let's get on that. Black British actors, in the 80s and 90s, where were they? How did we build the dynasty of black Hollywood that we built if they weren't around? If they're that good, okay,
mm-hmm.
because that's what everyone says, they're trained better. Okay, if they're that good, then where were they when we built that dynasty in the 80s and in the 90s? When
mm-hmm.
we paved the way with the films, you know, New Jack City, Boys in the Hood, all those films, there was not one black Brit in them.
Mm-hmm.
How did we pave the way? How did we make it so far without them?
Right.
And it's okay, I'm not knocking British actors, black Brits in particular, because I love some black British actors. Noel Clarke, I respect tremendously what he's doing over there. He's in Britain, you know, in the UK, creating his own content.
Yeah.
Ashley Walters. Both of them working together, creating their own content. I respect them tremendously. I'd love to work with Noelle Clark if the project is right.
Mm-hmm.
But when you say, okay, here it is as an acting coach, the A-list actors and the up-and-coming actors that I coach who will write for some of these films, they go in and they hire me and they spend time. And I'm like, this is an amazing audition. Or they put it on tape and they don't even get a call back. And then you see the breakdown. Boom, it's a black Brit who just talked to the director or the producer and got the role. So then people have this belief that, oh, the best person got the role, but there wasn't an audition.
Right. Right.
There was no audition. This happened in the back room, or it happened in a bar somewhere, or it happened in the office. There wasn't an audition process.
Mm-hmm.
So how can you say that they're better? Why? Because they can put on an accent? I can put on an accent. Yeah. I can sit here and with a turtleneck and a jacket and totally talk like them. It's like it's presumptuous and it's bull.
Yeah.
So for me, it's a thing of saying, okay, the thing that people say all the time is they're like us. We're all the same. And as long as somebody black has the role, they have the role. Well, what happens to that finance? It goes back overseas. It doesn't stay here.
Mm-hmm.
You know, every top black British actor who has made it so far, without mentioning names, they've all created production companies. Bravo, good for them. Where are your production company at? It's overseas.
Okay,
so yeah. That's a new form of outsourcing that is dangerous to the black community because we're still young. You know, we were released in a capitalistic society with no capital. So mm-hmm. we're still figuring things out on how to be able to make projects because no one's bringing. Listen, I've made some of the best shorts in the past couple of years, and my first feature film went straight to Lionsgate. I've yet to have anyone hit me up for another project. That money's not there. And so how does it happen if I'm going to continue moving forward? I got to create my own content.
Right.
And so I don't, there's no venom to black British actors. I get it. And I get it with the directors and producers. They have to work with them sometimes because it's budgetary things. Mm-hmm. I get it. That's what people don't know. You see what I'm saying?
Right.
These agencies and people that are pulling the strings, they have to work with that talent. But that doesn't, and then they say, okay, well, you know, Americans are lazy and, you know, they're all about fame. Well, how is it going to be any different if you go in and the first thing the casting director asks you is what's your Instagram following like?
Right.
Which is what people don't talk about.
Uh-huh.
You walk in there asking how many followers do you have? Or the breakdown says, we'll not see actor unless they have more than 20,000 followers. So I can go and look up a British black actor who came over here, got a hot agent, and just come out the gate with a series as a series lead, and look at their Instagram, and they got maybe 2,000 people or less.
Mm-hmm.
So why is it different for us?
Mm-hmm.
Why is it that I got to have over 20,000 or 40,000 or 50,000? And so people were getting mad at Samuel Jackson asking that question, but I don't think they went deep enough to understand what he was saying by that. Because they're like, okay, so look, real quick. I don't have to do Shakespeare to know how to play Tyrone with a gun smacking a chick as a pimp. That's
right.
Not going to make me a better. You know, how is Shakespeare going to help me in that regard?
Right.
You know what I mean? You know, so for me, it's a thing of, you know, it's that Key and Peele skit where the British guy says, you know, when you're with your mom, you know, when I think about it, I think about my mom. And, you know, it's like, what? What are you talking about? And he's like, man, I live this, man. I've killed people.
Right.
You know?
Right.
And so, yes, there is a lot more of a depth in the soul there. Or going to August Wilson.
Mm.
And you can see when actors don't understand because the period is disengaged, this generation. So my actors have to work August Wilson. They have, yes, they do Mammoth. They do, you know, say, mm-hmm. all the other great plays, but they have to do August Wilson.
Yeah.
They have to understand it.
Yeah.
You know?
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Shout out to Kenya.
Yeah.
to Kendra.
Kendra, yeah. Understand it, for sure. All right. Well, I'm going to go into a special part of the show.
Okay.
All right. I'm going to say five quotes.
Okay.
From famous black films.
Ooh.
And you have to finish the quote. Okay. So we're going to do five. We're going to see how much you get. Okay.
All right.
All right. Here we go. His mama named him Clay.
Ooh. His mama named him Clay.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, no, you got me. I mean, I'm probably sure I seen the movie, but...
Yeah, I'm sure you have.
Ooh, that quote right there, his mama named him Clay. I'm probably going to laugh when you say it, because I'm like, yeah, I seen the movie, but I don't know that quote.
Okay, I'm going to call him Clay from Coming to America.
Barbershop scene.
Barbershop scene, yeah. Yeah.
Coming to America, you know, I've seen it several times. It's not one of my favorites, honestly. No?
No. All right, next one. Make that money, girl.
Yeah, make that money, girl. Don't make that money. Don't let that money make you.
Hey, yeah, that's it. Yeah, there it is.
That's the Players Club,
right? All right, here's another one. You ready?
Yeah.
Oh, there you go.
late thing.
So now you're going to shoot me in.
Oh, that's Harlem Nights.
Yeah.
You shoot me in my pinky toe.
There you go.
Della Reese.
Della Reese, rest in peace.
Yes,
great talent.
Soul.
Yeah.
Amen.
All right.
You got some hard ones here.
You show
is ugly.
Color Purple.
Shout out to Color Purple.
Yes.
I wasn't offended. There was a lot of men during that time that were monsters like that. So
yeah, it was.
You got to be honest.
All right. So, if you don't get this one.
I need to stop coaching.
Sit your $5 ass down.
Before I make change.
Hey.
Yes. Nino Brown.
Nino Brown.
Yes.
Jack City.
New
there
Jack
you go.
City.
Yep. Good job. Let's round applause for Tony.
So I just got off on one.
You just got the one.
And you started out with Coming to America.
Hey.
Damn, come on.
Coming to America 2 coming soon.
Coming soon, yeah.
Yeah, can't wait
God
for that
God bless
one.
Them all, yeah.
All right, and this I'm going to ask you some questions. These are fast questions, okay?
Okay?
So this is the part of the show where I ask you a question,
okay.
You be sharp,
okay.
First thing that comes to your head,
okay? It might be bad because it might all be sex. That's bad.
It's okay, let's do it.
All right,
here we go.
Okay.
What's your favorite word?
Shit.
All right. What's your least favorite word?
That's a good question. Hater.
Hater, okay. Something that turns you on.
Sex.
Something that turns you off.
Hate for God.
Oh, okay. Sound or noise that you absolutely love.
Applause.
Sound or noise that you hate.
A shaky voice.
Oh, okay, like nervousness or like, okay, trembling. What profession, other than your own, would you like to participate in?
Psychiatry,
okay. What profession would you absolutely not?
Oh, I'm never going back to being a dishwasher. Never. I'm done.
Yeah.
But then, you know, let me add to that. I wouldn't want to be an agent or a manager.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right, yeah. I can see that one. Mm-hmm. Heaven exists. Get up to God. What would you like to hear him say to you?
Well done.
I think that was the quickest response. Like,
yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Awesome. Well done.
Well done.
Well done. Hey. All right. I'm going to go into two questions that we got from the viewers online.
Oh.
Okay. One of the questions is
fancy.
Coming in from viewership. One of the questions they asked, what do you find is one of the most difficult things dealing with actors? I don't know.
Focus.
Mm.
Focus, and just finding their north. A lot of them, they get distracted by everything. They don't know who they are. See, when you know who you are, nothing can distract you. It's kind of like, you know, I give a quote where Jesus said, this is my family.
Mm-hmm.
Those who follow me, those who hear my words are the ones that's my family. We get caught up in family and relationship issues, and those will overwhelm our sense of direction.
Right.
Because the I'm going to tell you, the film industry and the entertainment industry, period, is a jealous woman.
Yeah.
And it wants all and every part of your attention.
Mm-hmm.
And so a lot of actors come out and they think they can have that life, the normal life of people who normally have 2 weekends off or, you know, a couple of weeks off to go on vacations and holidays and stuff like that. Entertainment industry doesn't see it that way.
Mm-hmm.
It says, I need all of your time and attention.
Yeah.
And so people get caught up in thinking, well, I can live a normal life. I abhor mediocrity. Because once you realize who you are and why you're here, then you're going to do what you're supposed to do, no matter what.
For sure. And then the next question is, if you feel ever in a stuck, like, you know, you have times you work, you have times you're off as an actor, all that, what's one thing you do to keep going?
Create.
There it is.
If you're an actor, write. If you're a writer, act. If you're a director, write, act. Do it all. Put a camera up. Learn how to do an over-the-shoulder shot. And just create content. Just create. And people say, well, I don't know how. Okay, well, YouTube University.
That's right.
YouTube University. You coined that. I coined that, yes. Yes.
Coined that term, guy.
You got it.
Well, that's all the time we have for today. I thank you so much for joining me in the studio. It's been a pleasure. Thank you so much, everybody's watching and tuning in. You please go ahead and find us on iTunes, Spotify. Give us thumbs up if you like this. Subscribe. Black Hollywood Live. Thank you so much. We had an awesome time here in the studio. Choice, go ahead and tell everyone where to find you, and also mention Henry's Courage one more time.
Yeah, Henry's Courage on Kickstarter. Henry's Courage, both words together, / Kickstarter / Henry's Courage. And you can find me on DarkCon2000 on Instagram, and Breaking Through Acting Workshop on Facebook, and DarkAnent on Twitter 2000.
Sounds good. And you can find me everywhere at I Am Danny Royce. Thank you for tuning in. We'll see you next week. Same place, same time, inside the Black Actors Studio. Stay blessed.
On behalf of our BHL staff, we would like to thank you for tuning in to Black Hollywood Live, the world's first digital broadcast network devoted entirely to urban entertainment and pop culture. Check out our Black Hollywood Live YouTube page for even more great programming and amazing content. And be sure to subscribe and like our channel when you do. I'm your BHL host, Nakia Monet, and you can find me on all social media at Kiki Boom Boom or at Black Hollywood Live. Black Hollywood Live, Hollywood redefined.